Greetings, viewers. Adventure Link here. Back again for the first time in a while with a repair video. For being gone so long, I guess, you know, I'll go ahead and make this a 4-in-1 repair video. To sum it up, I'm going to call this fun with and without the windshield wiper and cowl assembly, which is right there. I apologize for my absence, but haven't been feeling too right. Lost my motivation. Didn't really have much to fix on the van until now.
The patient, of course, is a 2006 Dodge
Grand Caravan with the SXT package
with the 3.8 liter V6 engine. Although this should apply to pretty much any fourth generation Chrysler or Dodge minivan as a whole. Heck, let's probably see if you could take this one step further. I think this might even work on the third generation Chrysler, Dodge, and Plymouth minivans too. Feel free to try it out. Why am I calling this video Fun With and Without the Windshield Wiper Cowl? A very good question. On these fourth generation Chrysler and Dodge minivans, I've been told that if you want to get better access to the rear bank of the engine and anything underneath this cowl, you can pretty much remove it and get to anything you want to.
I guess it's one of the many things I can give Chrysler credit for, is that at least when it comes to these fourth generation vans, they thought of their service people and actually made the front wheel drive V-block engine struggles seem less of a struggle. In any case, removing this cowl here should make the following projects a little easier. For starters, you know, you've got a rear bank engine service back here, you know, like for the, you know, the PCV valve here, the spark plugs and wires, valve cover and gasket, head and the head gasket. You can't see them, but timing mechanisms, power steering pump. It's the front part of the engine, I know, but the back has an exhaust stuffs too, all the same, so there is that. Additionally, you have the brake booster, brake master cylinder, the ABS computer. See that little wire there? Yeah. If you can remove the cowl assembly, and running wires actually does, you know, get made easier, or not, you know, let me know. I mean, if it does make it easier, great. If it doesn't, well, don't come back to the comment section with a bunch of butthurt comments saying that I spread misinformation. Because, you know, this is an experimental thing. I'm not sure how well it goes, but whatever. Feel free to try it and let me know one way or another, but don't be surprised if it doesn't work, and don't leave me butthurt comments if it doesn't. Moving on, as you can see, it looks like we got some AC lines back there. Of course, you got the front struts, passenger and driver side. Power plant support. I call this out too because Eric the car guy recently did a fixing it forward series on a third generation Chrysler minivan. Part of the job required him to replace the transmission. So he had to put this gigantic metal bar up, which is one of his two options because he's got a lift. You know, he had to put that metal bar up. Now, of course, you know, going from third generation to fourth generation, as you can see, you know, there's probably not much more to destroy other than this fuse box and maybe a computer or two, but I believe he had the bar like right there and over here, which would have definitely destroyed some computers and the fuse block. The only way he would have been able to viably put the bar was where the struts go. And he was debating on removing the cowl himself. So, you know, thanks to Eric the car guy for, you know, making that quick call out. And that's why I'm calling it out here. Because on this channel, you know, we don't hurt ourselves. We don't destroy ourselves. We don't destroy stuff. As long as there's, you know, a safety, structural integrity, quality, etc. call out, you know, I will not hesitate to make it because all that stuff is number one on my channel. And I will see to that. Alrighty, so let's get started. First thing you can do is remove this cap here that blocks off the nut to the windshield wiper on. You'll use a flathead screwdriver for this. Beware of the like glue, gunk, whatever this is here. There will be some there, so keep that in mind. Next thing you'll want to do is you'll need a 14 millimeter socket. You'll put it over this nut.
Then you'll start to start the extraction process. There it is. Okay, so I want to make a real quick haul out here for the passenger side. You can see I had to use a different socket. This is the 15 millimeter socket on the passenger side. For some reason, there is no gloop or whatever was like in the other one, so I'm not sure what the deal with the lack of gloop and the deal with the bigger nut is, but whatever. Now, the next thing you want to do is prepare your wiper on puller. You may remember from my rear wiper removal video how I had a different puller. Unfortunately, that don't work, but this one here does. It's a battery terminal and wiper on puller. It's by Awhile. The pot number is 54150. And of course you get a nifty little instruction set on the back.
You can probably not see this or not see this because it's so bright out here. But as you can see, you know, you want to align the puller in such a way as to where the little tangs get underneath of the windshield wiper on. Then you'll rotate that big black plastic piece until it rests down on those wheel things. And then this thing up here with the little metal bar on it, you'll of course keep turning it clockwise and keep going and going and going till you get a gigantic pop. Then you can free the arm just like so. Now of course I freed this arm off cam because it really took me two hands and the power of a vice grip to get everything all set up. So be that as it may, you know, I got it off and I at least told you how to set it up. In any case, the passenger side wiper will remove the same way as the driver's side here. So from here, you know, you can put this in the van and keep it tidied away, and then you can pull the passenger side arm off. So that's what I'll be doing, and I'll see you all a little later. So the next thing you want to do is remove four Torx head screws. There's one right here, one down here,
one right there,
one right there,
one over here.
Last but not least, there's one right there. These are all T25 Torx head screws, and there are six of those, not four. My bad, sorry about that. And just as a fair warning, when dealing with Torx heads, there's this high maintenance bullshit with it where if you think you got the right size, think again, because it's likely you can go the next higher size and still be fine. You might be better off that way, because failure to do so can cause the head here to strip, if not your socket or nut driver or whatever, doing pretty much the same thing. Feel free to remove these six Torx head bolts, or screws rather, now.
So to remove the
first half of this cover, first find a way to clear the stud. Then from there you can squeeze this through and that side's freed. Then you can pretty much do the same thing to the other side.
The next thing you want to do is remove these four nuts here, 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 and one over here. They're all 10 millimeters.
Go ahead and remove these four nuts now.
Now you need to remove these 13 millimeter nuts. There's four of them. One here, one here, one here, one over here. You can get to them with a, don't let the stud fool you. You can bust these off with a standard size socket. Heads up, the windshield wiper washer hose may be in the way. You can always pull that out of the way. See, get to all four bolts easy with the standard 13 millimeter head.
Okay, now you'll need to get off some more 13 millimeter bolts. There's one there,
one back here,
one hiding out over here. There it is. And one hiding out right
there. It is right there. It is. There's four bolts. They're all 13 millimeters and you can pop them off with a quarter inch drive ratchet. See? Here I go. Whee! So go ahead and get those four bolts off now.
Okay, so you're probably wondering what happened here with this mess. Well,
pretty much all you got to do is just wiggle all these braces out one by one as they come out of these studs up at the top. Optionally, you can wiggle them out at the bottom too. It may make it easier, it might not, who knows. But in any case, looks like what we got holding us back now is this clamp over here, and this electrical connector. So let's start with this electrical connector. This looks like any other clamped electrical connector with the red tab. You just take your flathead screwdriver, pull off the tab out. Then from here, you can push back on this tab, pop the clip off for you, but basically you should be able to wedge your screwdriver in where the clip holds on to, where this part of the clip here holds on to this part, pop it loose, and then it should come down. Then from there, I guess you can move the hose down. Of course, it's a little difficult, so I had to do that off cam, but go ahead and do the same thing to the other side now. Then after you pop off the alligator clips, then you'll have to hold on to the hose, then move it down as you move each side of the assembly up. Then eventually you will have it freed. See that? Not on the pipes anymore, but it's still hung on here. So I'll try to find a way around that. All right, I just needed a little more elbow grease, but in any case, now what else is holding you back is you can either leave it like this or try to find a way out, get this out. I figured out how to free the windshield wiper washer tube from the rest of the system. This connector here, you know, you'll just carefully back it out by hand and eventually it'll come out. As a heads up, this is to the windshield wiper reservoir. This is to the rest of the system. So if, just in case you have to do any vacuum line work, don't confuse this with a vacuum line, or else you're going to get wiper fluid all over in the vacuum system. Well, you don't want to destroy that, but see, we now have room to do struts. See, passenger side and driver side. I can get my hands back here to the spark plug Y is at least. You'll probably have to play the touch and feely game for the plugs. Unless I can align them on the socket as is. AC line, I can get this crap out. Not a good idea to have this gunk in there anyways. And I can get to the PCV valve better. Yay!
Now to remove the windshield wiper assembly. Start off by removing these two 13 millimeter nuts.
Here. Put the nuts away. Then from here you can free the arm just like so. Passenger side over here is the same deal. Two 13 millimeters, then you can free it just like the other side. Move the braces out of the way if you didn't already do so. Mine's all out. Now you'll need to take off these 13 millimeter nuts. One here, one here, one here, one here. As a heads up, this one here, you know, is pulling the stud out. So if it does do that, you know, let it. All the same, it'll still screw back in, so it's not like you're gonna break it. See? There it is. Loosen this one, and you can undo it by hand. There it is. This one should come out nice and easy as well. There it is. Do the same thing back here. There it is. Then from here, you should be able to free the entire wiper assembly. Well, as long as you're not held back by braces,
You can remove it. There it is. It's pretty much almost all the way out except for that one electrical connector. Same deal as the rest, just pop out that red tab. And then you can push down on the, pop out the red tab, push down on this tab, and it should slide out. I got a little bit more crap in here.
Sweet.
I really don't see much of a viable way to remove the wiper transmission. You'll have to, it looks like you had to find a way to get this nut off though. Other than that, if you can find one that's an all-in-one unit, wiper, motor, and transmission, that would be super.
Well, I couldn't find any part numbers on the wiper, motor, or transmission, but I do have a nice little tip.
If you find like any of these popped out, you could pop it back in with a vice grip. That's what I ended up doing. Other than that, despite the fact that we did extract this, and I know it's not in a fully extracted state, but whatever. That's all there is to removing the windshield wiper, motor, and transmission on your 2006 Dodge Grand Caravan SXT package. Although this should work with the other fourth generation, possibly third generation Chrysler and Dodge and Plymouth for 3G minivans as a whole.
Let's proceed forward and get on with the plugs and wires.
Okay, so now it's time to get ready to do these plugs and wires here. Okay, so as a prerequisite, you want to make sure that your engine temperature is, you know, stone cold, you know, like before you run it for the first time, or if it's not stone cold, you know, you want to let it sit for a few hours, you know, like say 5, 6, 7 hours in the summer months, about 3, 4 hours in the winter to get it down to the cold mark and see my things and run, so you know my temperature is at the cold mark, so we cool. First thing you want to do is pull on a plug wire just like so, carefully of course. Yep, you want to make sure that the plug wire is not annihilated or destroyed as a fair warning, although we're going to replace the wires anyway. If that metal piece does not come out with the wire like so and it's on the plug, then you're going to have a lot of fun later on if you was to reuse these wires. Fortunately, this is also why we change our plug wires. Fortunately, this came out of the front, so this wasn't too bad. But had this been in the back, this probably would have been a lot of fighting, so keep that in mind. Okay, so as you can see, I got the socket on the spark plug, with a shorty extension, 3/8 inch ratchet. It's a 5/8 socket, and from there, you'll turn it counterclockwise. Be careful not to break the plug or anything. Just keep on going until it comes out, I guess. And after much fighting, we has plug. Yay! As a heads up though, these plugs are a little, I guess on the bare side, long extended in as you can see, but you'll have to keep that in mind. I guess this looks normal. If someone wants to let me know, that'd be super. So I got a Champion double platinum plug. As you can see, it's already locked and loaded and anti-seize to the max. So just as a heads up, I'm gonna put some anti-seize on the threads. I got a 6-pack here. A pot number, it's upside down, I know, but okay, here it is, right side up. Top number is 7440, and the bottom is RE14PLP5. You'll need 6 of these. Then we can come back to the back of the engine with everything locked and loaded, of course. And you'll have to play the touchy-feely game to get the plug into the hole. All right, so I got the plug in the hole. I'm tightening this by hand to start off with. Yep, just as a very, very fair warning, be sure you start these spark plugs in by hand. Do not use the ratchet just yet, because failure to get the plug in by hand, and if you cross-thread it, you can cause damage to the threads. Additionally, this is an aluminum head with an iron block. So I forgot to mention too about the don't do this with the hot engine thing, but if you do change spark plug for the hot engine, not only is that a safety risk anyway, because you're also fighting with the hot underhood components and that very piping hot spark plug, but you can also damage the head, damage the hole, damage the threads, all that other good stuff.
Not.
Then you'll keep battling with the ratchet. Then eventually it'll bite down. When it does, like it is, give it, you know, say about a quarter of a turn, just like so. You don't need to go any more than this. And the next thing you can do is remove the offending spark plug wire, just like so. If it's a difficult, you can use a vice grip. Be careful with the vice grip so you don't pop it. Additionally, as a heads up, you want to do plugs, you know, like a one-piece flow. So that's why I'm doing it as such, one at a time. That's the way you want to do it. It doesn't look like it needs it, but you could take a Scotch-Brite pad or something and clean that that coil tower before you apply the new wire. Of course, to make things go a little easier in the back, you could remove the vacuum hose that goes from here into the brake booster. That should help make things a little easier for you. Okay, another reason why I just preached one piece flow is, as you can see, this wire, you know, is close enough to what I have here. Unfortunately, this is the OEM wire, the one that's marked with the number 5. See, Chrysler was nice enough to mark these plug wires for you. Unfortunately, on this aftermarket wire, there is no number. All the same, it is a Autolite spark plug wire kit, 97052. So pretty much what you're going to have to do from here is measure each plug wire, and you have to use the closest best fit to go to each offending cylinder. Don't forget to put your dielectric grease into the hole. Then you can snap the new wire in. Snap it in. There, just like so. Then you'll feel around for the fresh plug. And now from here, you can take your plug wire and feel around for the plug. Then when it snaps on, you're good to go. Don't forget to do the same thing for the other 5 plugs as well. I want to make a quick call out to the front plug. See this little support thingy? It's there for a reason. The reason is it's likely that these plugs need to be separated physically like this. So when you take off the plug, you know, still do it one at a time, but keep in mind that the support's there. So make sure every single plug wire gets nestled back into its home. Wasn't an easy battle, but all the plugs and wires are all in. Now it's time for the maiden startup. Yeah, you definitely want to make sure that everything's going to run right before you put everything back together. Especially, you know, with this being a front-wheel drive 6-cylinder. So let's get it on.
Sweet.
Sweet. The van still sounds like it should. Now, for just to be sure, let's rev it up a little bit.
Sweet.
Van still runs. Now let's go inside, see if I've got any warning lights after playing with the throttle.
Sweet!
No warning lights! Look, Ma! I did it!
Yeah!
So, plugs and wires are all done. Just so you know, this is a 100,000 mile tune-up whenever your vehicle calls for platinum plugs. FYI, this is double platinum, so I guess the same rules apply. But that's it. We're all done with the spark plugs. Let's move on to the struts.
I decided to actually hold off on the struts for a moment because I want to say welcome back to the super amazing and spark plug job bonus footage, where I want to showcase the conditions of my plug. As I recall, this was 5, this was 3, this was 1. If it looks objectionable, you know, let me know in the comments. Let's see. This was 6, this was 4, this was 2. Either way, let me know how it goes. Okay, now it's time for the moment you've been waiting for.
The strut.
As you can see, I already took the liberty of jacking the vehicle up. As you can see, it's got my my little Rhino ramp block in the back. You'll want to put the Rhino ramp in the block. The Rhino ramp block first, or the cinder block, or whatever it is you're going to jack it up with. Put that back first. Then jack your vehicle up. Make sure you have it on jack stands if you're using a jack and stands. Otherwise, you can use a drive-on lift or a forearm lift. Do not use ramps. It will not be of help to you. Make sure your load is squared and secured. Despite the fact that this vehicle is supported by only one jack stand, because the tire's on the other side, I've done this before. When I lost my tire one time and I let it sit at the house for a couple days, and Firestones did the same thing, so it's a pretty legitimate way to support a vehicle with one jack stand if you so desire. Like me, if you like to run out of strength a lot. Okay, so here are the part numbers for the struts. Just so you know, it's the same part number. One just says L, the other says R. Keep in mind that, you know, L means for the driver's side, R means for the passenger side. Keep that in mind when you are ordering the strut and when you go to put them on the vehicle. Okay, now normally there'd be a sway bar, you know, going from up here to down there. Unfortunately, this and this is pretty much all that's left of it, because I've really, really had to fight with this one. As you can see, you know, this looks like a T30, T35, T40 head. Well, of course, you know, it'll be the higher heads whenever you strip this out accidentally. Additionally, I have heard of like 5 or 5.5 millimeter Allen keys fitting this. The nut here is like 18 or 19 millimeters. It could vary. As you can see, I had to take a Sawzall to this. I've literally tried everything I could, and then eventually this became stuck. I didn't get a chance to try it up top, but I at least managed to fry this one up nice and good. I want to thank my buddy Selim Tan Riverty. I believe I got that right. If I didn't, I apologize. What he suggested to do was, you know, take your map gas torch or acetylene torch, heat this up until, you know, turns like bright red, and then soak it down to penetrating oil, and then very quickly, as quick as you can, you know, put your wrenches on the nut, and then, you know, you want to take your ratchet, put it in the tighten position, and then take your box wrench and then turn it counterclockwise to loosen it, and that should pop the nut loose. If you can get it all the way loose and reuse your sway bar link, you know, that'd be super, that'd be better to do. But if you ultimately had to cut it off like I did, oh well, that's all you can do. So if you had to get this far and had to savage it off there like I did, then you're gonna need another sway bar, which I will tell you all about it in a moment here. Right now, let's just get to the two bolts here that support the strut to the steering knuckle. As you can see, these are 21 millimeters. They're not going anywhere. That's 21 millimeters. I believe the metric equivalent would be 13/16. The backside also appears to be 21 millimeters or 13/16. See, it's not moving. As a tip, if you've got an impact, like I do, an electric impact, or, you know, a standard air compressor type rack impact, then you should be able to just loosen these nuts off without a problem. Otherwise, you know, you'll just have to put a wrench on one side and your socket on the other or something. Either way, make sure you do apply penetrating oil and or some heat to help you get the nuts and bolts off. Quick tip, as you can see, this is a tapered thread. So that means it's going to be difficult to get out. What you want to do is you want to take this nut here and you want to try to get it as flush as you can with the end of the bolt. Then you want to take your hammer or rubber mallet, give it a few good whacks, hard whacks, mind you, and then
And the bolt will come out, then you can take the nut out. And from there you can keep on going until it all comes out. Just as a fair warning, make sure you do have this nut as flush as you can with the end of the bolt. Failure to maintain that can cause the end of the bolt to mushroom, and you will get problems with removal of the bolt later on. Before going any farther, you know, consider leaving one or both of the studs in like almost all the way like this. This way you're not putting so much stress on the CV axle, the lower control arm, ball joint down there, etc. Because this will come down. So as you can see here, I have a... It is a 13 millimeter socket. Yep, 13 millimeters. That's what you'll need to take off these three nuts at the top of the strut. Feel free to remove them now. Struggle is real, especially when you're using a quarter inch drive ratchet. But as you can see, it can be done. See? Done just fine. Okay, so as you can see, you know, I already got all the struts in, the strut in for you. Took the liberty of doing that off cam. There it is. As a heads up, to make this a little easier, when you get the strut in, you know, tighten down these three nuts up here. Towards like, you know, say like three threads or something. Because if you start like tightening all the way down up here, then that means you're going to have a difficult trying to align the steering knuckle down here to align for the bolts at the bottom here. Then tighten these up. Heads up, when you're torquing this down, you'll need a socket or a wrench or a socket back here to hold this down. As you can see, this is a 18 millimeter box wrench. And the other side is 21 millimeters, just like always. I'm not sure if it is with sway bar links or not. I don't think it is because I did it on a Grand Marquis. But I did it on a Grand Marquis without too many problems when it comes to alignments. But just as a very, very fair warning, what they don't tell you when you have to remove struts, like say for a wheel knuckle R&R, CV axle R&R, strut R&R obviously, or anything else that dictates the removal of a strut, my personal advice, get your alignment checked. Because these two nuts down here and these three nuts up here help control your vehicle's alignment angle and configure it. So you will need to check or get your alignment angle at the very least checked, if not adjusted as necessary. Please don't ignore this. Don't be a turkey when you get your sway bar in and get your struts in. I hope struts in. Even if it's just one strut or both, get your alignment checked either way. So if you're replacing the sway bar links like I had to, some things to keep in mind. First off, I've got a moved unit. Pot number is K as in Kevin 7258. Same pot for passengers and driver's side. As you can see, there's an improvement from the original design. You don't have to use the whole Allen or Torx key and the bolt thing. Yay! Looks like you should be able to just screw this in. That's an 18 millimeter head, by the way, just so you know. Well, I lied about the installation of the sway bars links. As you can see back here, there's like a little provision there for a wrench. I personally got away with a 19 millimeter box wrench. Could maybe try an 18 and kind of get a better, tighter fit. But the nut for sure is definitely 18. Additionally, there is a Zerk fitting there. Apparently these were pre-greased. So keep in mind, like every time you do an oil change, grease your Zerk fittings up. That way you'll have long lasting sway bar links. If you're like me and you had to deal with the fun and games of having to heat and penetrating oil and leather rinse repeat until either your sockets break or you bust the nut off, or you end up having to Sawzall it, whatever comes first, or you just want to be like just in case anyway, I would go ahead and put some anti-seize on the threads, you know, just in case, because you'll definitely have to remove the top hole here at least when you do this next strut replacement. Which, just as you know, they recommend you replace your struts every 50,000 miles. Or, of course, whenever you get strut failures, Yeah, like if you go over bumps and get clicks and it comes back as a strut mount, then you'll have to replace that. Additionally, if you're getting strut oil coming out of the bellows, you'll have to replace the strut then as well, etc.
Also, keep in mind when you're installing the sway bar link, especially in the upper hole, what I did was I started down here to align it in and then got it in up at the top. What I did was I loosened the three nuts up at the top. Can't see them because I'm down there, but you know what three nuts I'm talking about. Then you'll have to jack the lower control arm up. So that way you can get those strut up in such a way as to where the ball joint for the sway bar link will insert into the hole. Good news, you can definitely use a socket to get it all the way in up there. Unfortunately, in the back, you can only get so far before you have to go back to a box wrench. Don't forget your anti-seize either way. The torquing spec is 65 foot-pounds. And feel free to go ahead and tighten these up. Torquing specs are as follows. So last but not least, tires. What I like to do is I like to line it in the holes, get the tires on the threads, or on the studs rather, put each lug in one by one, hand tighten them until I can't go no more, lower the vehicle on the ground, torque it, 95 to 105 foot-pounds, I do believe the spec is. Owner's manual release for the spare says it's a 95 foot-pounds. Which that's one of the many things I can say that I can give Chrysler credit for, is that at least for the spare, which I'm pretty sure applies to all tires as well on this van, they thought to give you the torque spec. That's a good thing. Also, what they don't tell you though, this is an aluminum rim. So say 50 miles, 100 miles after you do this job, or after you had to take off the tires for any reason, come back with your torque wrench and check over the torque again. Just to make sure everything's all tightened down. And as you can see, everything's pretty much assembled now. That's it, you're all done. You just changed the strut on your 2006 Dodge Grand Caravan, although this should apply to all 4th gen Chrysler and Dodge minivans as a whole. Let's go wrap this up. Well, this has certainly been one heck of a doozy of a job. Took me a few days to do it all. So with that being said, you know, I want to share my insights and thoughts on the jobs that were covered in this video today, or whenever, because it took me 3 days, like I said. Anyways, first and foremost, you know, every time you do one of these little jobs under the hood where you had to take the windshield wipers off, you know, make sure you do test drive it, test it out. That way, in case you say get a misfire in the back of the bank of the engine, or if you leak oil from the valve cover, or you screwed up the installation of the struts or whatever, you're not all like, ah, crap, I gotta take this all down again. Whereas, you know, if you find the problem, you know, you can get right there and start fixing it up. Additionally, so like I said, this took me, you know, a few days to do, so it's probably gonna take you a few days to do too if you do all the jobs in this video. Make sure you do check the weather, you know, just in case it's gonna rain. Try to set aside at least 3 to 4 days, preferably, like I said, those days without rain, because there are some difficult bolts, and in my case, you know, I guess I kept losing my strength a lot. That was why it took so long. Let's get on with the individual jobs. The windshield wipers, really don't have much to say about those. It was pretty straightforward, pretty simple, easy stuff. And the only difficult thing about it would be the alignment of the wipers. As you can see, that's not supposed to do that. However, the right side's okay, but I gotta go back and fix the left side, so keep that in mind when you align it. Additionally, I did manage to kick a couple problems in the butt. I did have some clicking in my wipers whenever I would use them. It ended up being some of the linkages in the transmission. If you run into this problem, you can do what I did and use a vice grip, or you could probably use like a small to mid-size C clamp. That should pop everything back into place. If everything's like so damaged and you're just gonna have to get another motor and transmission, there's not much you can do about that. Fortunately, I was able, like I said, pop it in, everything's good. Additionally, I was also not spraying the windshield wiper fluid, despite the fact I didn't have a dash light on my dashboard for low fluid. So I'm not sure what became of that, but I did secure all my lines better and test it all out and everything was good. So yeah, nice fixes of $0 and 0 cents FTW. The struts, I got a lot to say about the struts.
First off, that was actually the bulk of my difficultness. The spark plugs, of course, being a distant second place because I was at least able to do the plugs on one day, but the struts, I ended up having to have my buddy Danny do the driver's side the next day, but I was able to do the passenger side on the previous night. And there was, you know, a lot of fatigue and fighting with the bolts and all that. Keep that in mind. The main thing to watch out for, though, is the sway bar length. Like I said, that's pretty much where the bulk of your difficulty is. This was not a decision I make lightly, but I ended up having to sawzall the sway bar link off of where the sway bar is. You know, honestly, I've tried everything to get it off. Torch, PB blaster, vice grips, the Torx head provision, which I ended up wasting like several sockets because of that. I do want to thank Salim, Selim, T. I forgot his last name, but his first name is Salim or Selim. If I mispronounce that, I apologize. Anyways, he was the one that told me to apply the heat liberally until the nut and or the stud, you know, turns bright red, and then soak that shit down with PB blaster. And because of that, I was able to free the bolt, you know, somewhat. That was the good news. Bad news, unfortunately, is it kept getting stuck, but I was at least able to get it free long enough to get a sawzall through. The passenger side sway bar link, it actually ended up coming off in several pieces. The ball joint for that was still on the old strut. The sway bar housing itself, you know, fell on the ground, and then I had to sawzall the other part of the sway bar link off of the sway bar. This wasn't a decision I made. I made lightly, but there it is. I would honestly prefer you all to do it right and try to take the sway bar off the first time. But on the other hand, too, since you had to take half the sway bar off anyway, why not just do the entire thing? I know some guys are going to get all blood hurt or ask me about quickie struts. Be like, hey, Link, what you doing with those quickie struts? You know, you can rebuild those, right? Good point and good question. I chose to use quickie struts mainly because of safety reasons. When you have to take apart the struts, you know, keep in mind that the spring has a lot of energy in it. So if you're stupid enough to actually take the strut nut off, you know, the one in the center of the strut mount, take that off, that means that spring is going to come unloaded, and you can at the very least severely injure yourself, if not cause death, not to mention personal injury. As a heads up, even Eric the car guy almost paid the price a couple times on camera because of the strut compressor was not of good quality, I think it was, and it kept falling apart. So, you know, and he too had to suffer the problem of the strut spring energy almost about to hurt him or kill him. Additionally, there are also structural integrity things too. You know, when you're getting a quickie strut, you're pretty much getting fresh everything. Strut, the little bumper thingy that goes in between the metal part and the part that bolts to the strut mount itself, spring, gasket. And in this case, I even got new hardware for my strut. Yay. Unfortunately, these quickie struts or pre-assembled struts, you know, are pretty pricey compared to just getting the individual part. But when it comes to freshness and your safety, personally, I would recommend quickie struts. But if you do still want to rebuild the strut anyway, you know, I'm not going to stop you. You know, that's your call. My call is to use quickie struts all the way. I would expect you to respect that, just like I would respect all you all that say rebuild the struts all the way. So please don't leave me any butthurt comments because I chose to use quickie struts. Also, as a final note on the struts, I would like to say that if you do rebuild the struts, you know, do make sure you have a good compressor, preferably something that you can bolt to the wall securely and solid. If you do have to use those compressor and a little box thing, you know, like those plastic boxes, you know, be careful with those either way. Make sure you have a good quality compressor, you follow the instructions, observe all the safety warnings, and heed that spring-loaded energy with respect, please. That way you do not hurt or kill yourself or destroy property. And one more thing, struts, they do recommend you replace at 50,000 miles. However, if there are legitimate needs to replace struts, like spring damage or you're leaking strut oil, or if the strut mount's gone bad, then consider replacing the strut anyway. If you had to replace it beforehand, you know, I would advise changing the brands. But if you can go past 50,000, you know, that's great. Also about, I know I said one more thing, but I do want to say something about the springs. If you do rebuild the struts, you know, make sure you do check your spring over real good. Many people will reuse the springs. I will agree with that and say that you can. Just make sure you check it over pretty good to make sure it's not split, damaged, cracked, rusted out. If it is, you know, you have to replace the spring. But if the spring is still good, my advice to you is to take some Rust-Oleum or similar product, spray the spring down nice and good, and then put it back together, and you should be able to have a good spring free of rust for many years and miles to come. This was, like I said, going to be a 4-in-1 video. Thankfully, due to unforeseen circumstances, it was. And by all rights, it should have been 5-in-1. But I was wanting to tackle the PCV valve. Unfortunately, I ended up breaking it. I looked on 3 different sites, fixshed.com, iFixit, and even the Chrysler Minivan Fan Club forum. They all agreed with the little metal tube on the PCV valve. You take a vice grip, clamp it down nice and tight, rock it out slowly and carefully, and be patient because it takes a long time. Unfortunately, I broke the little metal tube, and whatever little bit of nubbin I had, I just had to reform it to be, you know, a square, and then hope for the best. Thankfully, on these Chryslers, the hose for the PCV valve actually goes over the entire fitting on the valve cover rather than just on the little metal tube like some other PCV valves do. So thankfully there was that, and I wasn't grounded or nothing. I had to tow it to a shop to free my PCV valve. So we're good for a little while longer on that, I guess. I guess I'll make a second attempt at the valve if I ever had to do a valve cover video, because I can probably at least show you that and try to get in from the back way. That's probably the only viable way I can get in now at this point, is to take the valve cover out and press it out, like say put a socket in and take a metal hammer or rubber mallet and pound it out of there, and then press in the new PCV valve. That's enough of my rambling. That's all the video there is of this video, and I hope this 4-in-1 repair job, you know, more than makes up for my time off of YouTube and making YouTube videos for YouTube. And for whatever it's worth, you know, there are other jobs that does require the windshield wiper to come off. I will at least link this video in the video description and direct you to take the windshield wiper assembly off for that. As for the other jobs, you know, it's going to be pretty involved, especially when it comes to engine work. So I figured it'll be for the better to spend those off into different videos, because I didn't want to drag this one out too far. I just wanted to keep this one simple and keep it down to simple jobs that you can do without the windshield wiper assembly. Anyways, this has been Adventure Link. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, praise, criticisms, well wishes, prayers, etc. But no flames, fighting, spam, butthurt comments, baiting, or such bullcrap. I'd ask you to take it down in the comment section. As always, thanks for watching. Make sure you rate and subscribe. The buttons are in the video description. Hope this video teaches you something and how to fix your vehicle and do these jobs and lead you to a successful diagnosis and repair. If you have any other questions about Chrysler, Dodge, and Plymouth minivans as a whole, I would ask that you head on over to the Chrysler Minivan Fan Club forum. Additionally, if you're on Facebook, you can look on the Chrysler and Dodge Minivan Owners Group. Join up, search the forum, search the group, post your questions. The fine folks there at either medium will be happy to answer any question you have in a timely manner. It's warm outside, so don't do what I did and have a red face and red arms and all that. Do wear your sunscreen if you can stay in the shade. You know, at least wear your sunscreen. You know, stand in shade, stay cool. Don't get red face and red skin. It's not comfortable. But either way, you know, stay hydrated, stay healthy, eat right, and stay active.
Work hard, have fun, and make history. See, it even says that on the back of his t-shirt here. But in any case, you know, don't let others push you around. And this is Adventure Link signing off with the wise words of wisdom from Eric the Car Guy, reminding all y'all out there to be safe, have fun, and of course, stay dirty. Until then, peace out. I'll see you all next video.